Thank you so much, Dale. I am going to read from a book that came out in September called Unidentified Sign Objects. I read down here this fall, so some of you have heard some of these poems before. And you can see me afterwards for a tuition reduction coupon. I'm going to begin with a villanelle called Climate. Elise, age 9, worries about the ice and polar bears with no place to go. She lies in bed, alert to her fraught life. Downstairs, her mother weeps. The words wife, unfair, too long, elongate and explode. Elise, age 9, worries about the ice. Her father tries to soothe this endless strife. He talks like that, full of what he calls woe. She lies in bed, alert to her fraught life, where no beautiful animals entice little girls to live in homes of snow. Elise, age 9, worries about the ice. Igloos melt, mothers mutter, knife the empty kitchen air, pace to and fro. She lies in bed, alert to her fraught life. What's been done is done not so much in spite as fear. Love marooned on a floe. Elise, age 9, worries about the ice. She lies in bed, alert to her fraught life. There are a couple poems in this book. I've done a lot of homages to artists over the course of my career. And there are two in here to photographers. I'm going to read one of them. There's a great African-American photographer named Roy DiCarava, who worked and lived in Harlem, worked in New York City, and took a lot of great photos of the jazz world in New York in the 50s. And 60s, really extraordinary artist. So this is one of his it's one of his photos. It's of two people in a club. It's a white woman and a African American man. It's called The Present Tense of Jazz, on a photo by Roy DiCarava. Prim, in a dress, a jumper, a young white woman listens. A few tables away, a young Negro man wearing a carefully knotted tie listens. It must be past midnight. Reason has headed home. Only a few seekers still are up, tapping their internal feet to the sound the planet would make if it could riff a bit on its axis. Invite a few stars down to agglomerate the gravity. Though bound by time and space, you can feel these two people aren't likely to speak. They're listening. That feels sad. The miserable starch of history floating on top of the unmelted pot, but feels right and respectful too. Since with each note their souls throb and faint, since as people they didn't know they were so big and small, so free, despite themselves. These two people in New York City in the 1950s, not looking further than the moment, not touching one another, which could make you weep for the loneliness of being in a body, and praise it too, their dignity, the music you can't hear, but must be there. I'll come and read another poem now that's concerned with music, but of a very different sort. This one goes out to Elizabeth Hastings. Ode to the DC 5. You read that the bassist in the Dave Clark 5 has died and think you didn't like the Dave Clark 5 that much. They were peppy, but not a whole lot more, overdoing their British notion of joy that wore thin in 2 minutes because it lacked sex and darkness that, to the Brits' credit, the Stones would soon provide. But you're sad anyway, because you feel how even nostalgia slips away, how no one knows what George Washington was really like. We'll never sniff his breath, or watch him clack his dentures, or hear him say a word like constitutional. And that hurts, not because you're afraid of oblivion, which would be silly, but because it's a drag how every story has to have the same ending. That's the beauty of poems, though, how they don't care about that. Poems just care about a teenage guy fumbling around with a bass and then starting to get the plunk, plunk hang of it and meeting some other guys and starting a band or joining a band and thinking, hey, this is fun. And hey, I'm going to get laid. And lots of good thoughts like that, which come way before death, and that are immaterial because although the music isn't immemorial, it doesn't have to be, because nothing has to be. Its failures are alluring as its successes, maybe more so. Since genius is so rare, the chance of some genius Liverpudlians coming together being about the same as you buying a Powerball ticket and winning $63 million, which still wouldn't buy immortality, but would give you a great stereo system to listen to the Dave Clark 5. Though after a while, you'd realize you don't need a great stereo system to listen to the Dave Clark 5. That in fact, it makes the experience worse. Because you keep expecting something musical, and that wouldn't be the Dave Clark 5. Or its bassist thumping along like a flat tire, and that pimply esprit feeling pretty bogus as the decades go down in a hail of gunfire and grief or quiet bank accounts or grandchildren. But poetry doesn't care about that. It's not an obituary. It's a lifetuary, which in its way the Dave Clark 5 was, getting at how swell it is to be young and full of snappy sap and not knowing anything and not listening to anyone and being not much more than a gyrating body homing in on some homely lass who swoons with delight at the opening bars of Catches If You Can, even though she knows the Beatles are way better than this stuff. It doesn't matter. There are moments in life when anything will do, and you just go with that. You say yes to whatever is breathing hard in your face. Its breath may be like George Washington's, because he lived in some moments once upon a time. And though he'd never heard an electric bass, he must have wanted to rock out as a kid, because kids always want to rock out. That's what their bodies are telling them. To pick up a bass or another person or a constitution or a nation and start rocking, start plunking away, and feeling that though it's just you, some second person figment, that one uncharted day will dissolve into the listless ozone, it doesn't matter, because no one's counting how many ecstasy buttons you've pushed, because one is enough. I read this a little while ago up in Vermont. Someone said, what do you have against a Dave Clark 5? I'm tough. I've mentioned George Washington, and so when I was a kid a few years ago in my elementary classroom, there were two paintings on the wall. One was the Gilbert Stuart painting of George Washington, and the other was a painting of Columbus coming ashore into the New World. And, you know, even when I was 11 years old, I knew this is really jive, you know? Like, what is this? You know, this is very, very strange. It took a while, but I wrote about it. And, of course, I'm writing about it from not the Columbus guys, but the people who were here. It's called Bear. Imagine being the one who saw the wooden boat clatter ashore. The strange men stepped forward and heard their harsh voices in the morning wind. Imagine calling your people together and beginning to tell your vision, the day no longer a day, but a story fashioned by unwanted gods. Imagine wringing sense out of what was senseless, or a fraction of premonition, doom and demise at last arrived, safe and stupidly sound. They looked absurd, those bearded men who dropped to their knees and intoned impossible words, who raised hands and eyes to the sharp with light sky. Imagine being the one, the first, the bearer of tidings that will transfigure death and ruin joy. Imagine the one running back to his tribe, short forever of breath. Okay, poets have long memories. So this is based on a meter that peaked around the time of Beowulf. So it's alliterative, and you'll hear the alliteration in here. It's called Haircut 1956. Men must be mundane, their virile vanity veiled in crew cuts, critique of hair, head honed to thin thrust of follicles, fine flatland, extreme the empty edge. But Bob the barber sharpened shears, shook ample aprons, aimed tonic and talked TV, Ike, illness, invasions of countries by communist killers, while the wealth of weeks fell formlessly, the fix of lessened locks lightly combed, the cunning clack and whack, whelming, wavy sensuousness, Samson's strength, beggared, bound, buzzed. Doing things like that, it's like a dog walking on its hind legs, you know, it has a quality. I can do this. Okay, this is another one. My poetry is a lot about collisions of past and present, because as Faulkner said, the past isn't even over. And, that seems to me essential even semi-keeping your wits about you in this amnesiac, you know, society. So a number of the poems in here are odes, which is, again, an old form that's capacious. You can put different things in it. So this, there was in the late 19th century, some of you I'm sure know about this, there was a religious movement among the Plains Indians primarily called the Ghost Dance. And it was part of the movement was this dance in which basically They dance to make the white people leave, go, die, and the buffalo to come back since they had been slaughtered. So this is called Ode to the Ghost Dancers. Busy with time, I forget out of time how to recall. The stars shuffle in their recondite heaven. To hear them, I must be still. To hear them, I have to open my beleaguered head. How much money did I make today? The spirits watch and grimace. Thousands of Indians shuffle their feet, a thin yet supple sound. If you stand outside Walmart, Taco Bell, Eddie Bauer, the shilling hearts of the fluorescent republic, and are very still, above the cars starting, people prattling, radios broadcasting, you can feel the tremor of moccasin feet shuffling, not stopping, dancing past exhaustion, past hope and hopelessness, to a place out of time, but in life. The concise moments of crickets, beavers, buffalo on a lush prairie, ravens talking. Have you seen the Indians? They are almost all dead, but they have plenty of ghosts. No ghosts for sale in Walmart, Taco Bell, Eddie Bauer. Only those hungry ghosts buying 12 packs of paper towels, extra sauce, signature twill shirts, chanting Walmart, Taco Bell, Eddie Bauer, Walmart, Taco Bell, Eddie Bauer, Walmart, Taco Bell, Eddie Bauer, Walmart, Taco Bell, Eddie Bauer. I forget how many died for this. How many were scalped, eviscerated, speared, arrowed. Their ghosts are angry too. But the Indians continue to dance. The troops ride into the encampment at wounded knee and start shooting. Screams, many screams. Everyone moves on, nothing comes back. But like sun and clouds and stars, the spirits are undeterred. They hear the shuffling feet, the cries that pierce the squander of grief. Okay, a lot of these clearly come from my fertile imagination. But this one comes very much from my life. It's called Ode to Speech. Still fumbling with words, as if attempted eloquence could preserve you in my backward sight, as if your death held other deaths at bay. I see you emerging from the old 88, a bandage on your head, that the scarf you bought at Liberty of London on your one trip abroad doesn't quite cover. And you shrunken inside your winter coat and moving very slowly, tottering would be the word, though you were only 47 and trying to form a smile of some sort, a desperate smile, a smile to rid you of pain and the weariness that eats my very bones, a smile to show you were fighting back as you taught me to fight back when the world taunted me. You halted on the sidewalk as if to take in the cold breeze, as if after weeks away, weeks in a small white room. It was a pleasure. The raw January air, how it shoved and gnawed at a body's modest warmth. You looked around slowly, your neck creaking, it lately having done little more than prop up your cancer-besieged head, and tried to say something, maybe about the sky or house, or our German shepherd lady who wagged her tail bravely, but no words came out, none. Only a rueful blankness, more of that stolid fumbling that was the ruin of each laugh and kiss and exclamation. You seemed bewildered to be there, to be alive, to be expected to respond when all that lay in front of you was coming to a bed and waiting, patient and impatient, for what the words "nothing more to be done" signified. You told me you'd overheard those words, one intern informing another. "I love you all," you said then on the sidewalk, to the dog and your husband and us children. But you didn't smile. Your words were quiet and grave, like the words in a speech, but from the depths of words, their blind insides. Okay, there are a number of formal poems in here. These are quatrains. It's called "Upon Hearing of the Death of a Former Lover." Again, the dawning flush of your pale flesh, you undressing slowly back to me, then turning and smiling, wry and winsome. "What you wished?" you asked. "Not a question," I stood in reply. Then the full skein of you rubbing against me and the smooth static of our different but one bodies. Passion that even now, decades later, makes memory whimper. I pace on the back porch among shovels and returnables, hear your meter of grunts and gasps. I stop, protest your name like a faith. Okay, now I'm going to revisit this blockhead self I was talking about the other day. I'm happily banished by the wisdom of age. So this is called Port Authority, 1969. For those of you who haven't been there, that's the big building in New York where the buses come in. It's going to begin really just coming right at you. So. The way these things can happen. "Les chicks," the pock Puerto Rican man who seemed to me to be somewhere out there in the tundra of late middle age, asked as I headed from my bus towards some distant exit in the Port Authority, whose name always confused me since there were no boats or docks. "No thanks, sir," I replied. "I'm going to hear the Allman Brothers at the Fillmore East," as if that somehow explained something. I kept walking, as did he. "One thing, sonny, I want to tell you, is call me any fool thing, but not sir." In front of a staircase, we both stopped. I eyed his hair, dosed with tonic, and slick back, a la 1956. "You understand me, sonny? I'm under the heel, not above the heel. You get it?" Half earnest, half contemptuous, he leered appropriately. "Yes, sir," I answered. He regarded me with visceral wonder. One thing I forget, Sonny, is stupid. No matter how much I see it and I fucking live it, I forget. He shook his head. A lock of oily hair fell forward. A guy in a business suit edged up to us. "You Hector?" the guy asked. I wanted to yell something like, "How much?" or "How long?" or "What the hell happens?" But the moment dissolved into the ugly lights and trash on the floor and the night outside, minatory the way night is supposed to be. I'm not going to get picked up by this, you know, come to New York City campaign. Okay, a couple more. Again, and I write about collisions, and this is perhaps one of the ultimate ones. Jerry Lee Lewis in Nuremberg. So this refers to the Nuremberg trials. It also refers to the movie Judgment in Nuremberg, which Spencer Tracy and, you know, after the war, the Second World War, a very small group of Nazis were prosecuted. And Jerry Lee Lewis is still out there. He just made a record, wonderful record, called Rock and Roll Time. I think that's about all you need to know here. Jerry Lee Lewis in Nuremberg. In unreal time, as when a head dices up decades, centuries, millennia, while slowly sluicing into the nether bog of sleep, Jerry Lee Lewis, also titled The Killer, for among other things, his pianistic prowess, appears at Nuremberg in a stiff, wide lapel suit he could have bought at Lansky's in Memphis if he was from Memphis, but he wasn't. Standing there with that too cool hairdo to confront the modest panoply of Nazis who are standing in for many Nazis who are there to take the rap and glad in their "we are the superior race" way to do that. Since it was a service to Aryans to cleanse the earth of scum, which by implication included musicians humping pianos and 13-year-old cousins while braying like country western boogie-woogie banshees. Jerry Lee has no time to dig this whacked-out ideology. He doesn't give a teenage shit about the tatters of their goose-stepping, zig-heiling murder machine. What matters is the sweet dross in his love-exercised mind. An undressed woman and some get-down hands hurricaning a keyboard, which is what a mind should hold, so that when Guri starts in with his witty repartee, Jerry Lee says, "You are one sad motherfucker." And the world, for once, gets what it is to be American and unafraid of what anyone thinks, especially some Nazi slimeball who believes he's better than anyone else because he's from Europe and has a lot of unhappy history up his vicious asshole that got made into more history that soldiers like my Uncle Nathan paid for with his life on the beach at Anzio, his precious blood vanishing into the grievous sands of silence. Goering says something smug, but Jerry Lee is busy waggling his eyes around the courtroom. No chicks or pianos. Being serious is fucking boring. Being serious has killed a lot more people than not being serious. The dream ends here. In Hollywood Times, Spencer Tracy is talking about the real complaining party in this courtroom, which is civilization. Everyone nods at this large last word. It sounds good, like maybe you could use it in a song. Each syllable taut, yet sibilant in its brief articulate leap. Though it doesn't rhyme with much, though it feels like some wish, something badly out of touch. Okay, two more. I had a request from the back of the room. Sometimes when you're in this business is not the right word. I have a poet friend who was audited by the IRS, they looked at her income, they said, "I'm sorry, but this is a hobby." Oh, that hurts. That really, really hurts. She is someone who has published about 7 or 8 books, teaches at Vermont College, and it's a hobby. So consequently, there are journals out there which put on their masthead, as it were, the title of this poem, which is, "Don't send us any poems about poetry." Who can blame them? Okay, so of course that's my poem. Another hallooing species of pathos, dewy assertion meeting tactless fact, while sad or puissant self stands downstage muttering about flowers, bread, time's witless unsigned aggression pact, as acerbic gods rain shit, war, unrequited everything on one more lover's brimming, aggrieved, near desperate head. Every moment a triumph in the sweepstakes of random abiding feeling. Fingers clutching air, umbrella handles, wet matches meant to set afire glacial mysteries. The whole rank savor of unwanted memory seeping through words terminably. Okay, and I'll leave you with the last poem, which is called Leaving. Not to be here anymore. Not to hear the cat's fat purring. Not to smell wood smoke, wet dog, cheap cologne, good cologne. Not to see the sun and stars, oaks and asters, snow and rain. Every form I take mostly for granted makes me sad, but pleased to be writing down these words, pleased to have been one more who got the chance to participate, who raised his hand, although he didn't know the answer or understand the question. No matter, the leaving makes me sad. So much was offered so freely and completely. Thank you. Questions? Yes, Justin?
As you would have lived through every decade, and it changes...
Not everything.
I'm just intrigued how you have kept all those records of how you felt through the time, because memory is something I did not rely on too much, mm-hmm. But what are your, what do you see in there that respond to the rights of a certain
type. Good question. The funny thing is I don't really have much of a memory. And I also have never kept a journal my whole life. So all I can say is I'm sort of porous and permeable, so to speak, you know, and stuff comes in there and, you know, rests somewhere in there, you know, and then comes out somehow or another, you know. A very thought would say it's Jarrell or Berryman or one of those 20th century people who said, being a poet is like wandering around in an electrical storm waiting to be hit. You know? Sounds great, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Well, I tell kids in school that sometimes. They think, gee, maybe I want to be an accountant.
Can you just talk a little bit about your process? I mean, I'm not as familiar with poetry, so do you sort of come up with a concept and write a draft in one sitting, or is it over time?
No concept. Zero concept.
Oh, okay.
No ideas, no concepts, no. Just, this strikes me, that strikes me, words. It's, you know, it all comes back to words. Something strikes a spark, you know. I read about the Dave Clark Fly faces. I have a dream about a woman I was connected with many decades ago. And, things like that. So, I mean, it's all coming out of the subconscious, basically.
And so, does form or content or both direct it? Or
absolutely.
All of it?
Absolutely.
But not one thing predominantly over the other?
No.
Okay.
It's kind of a back and forth. Yeah. It's very much back and forth. I mean, obviously, if you write something like a villanelle, form is really making itself present. Right? But you want that. It feels right for what you're trying to write about. That's a poem of obsession. And that form takes you to that place of obsession. You can't get away from it.
Okay.
So, it's a good question. Somewhere about there? Yes, Mr. White?
Barron, talk a little more about collision poetry.
About what?
Collision poetry.
Collision, yeah. I think the Greeks called it drama. It's, basically one of the questions poetry asks is what does one thing have to do with another, which is a pretty basic human question. And the answer in this society, as far as I can tell, is they don't, you know? So I look at it as my job, as it were, since poets are these, you know, neglected people practicing their hobbies who essentially take on the stuff that the rest of the society pushes aside. So the rest of society gets to have, you know, Fox News and Eddie Bauer and all the other crap that this place manufactures, you know. Meanwhile, back at the ranch, there are a few people who are actually trying to sort of tote up the score about the whole thing, trying to do what the poet Gary Snyder called the real work, you know. And these unheralded heroes of our society, some of them are looking at these collisions, essentially, that underlie, the aim of this place is laudable. All kinds of different people trying to get along. The reality is slightly different from that, you know? So for me, always dealing with that heterogeneous quality of this society, which I grew up in Balmer Merlin, as we say down there. I went to an all-boys high school that was a third black, a third Jewish, a third Protestant, with a smattering of Catholic guys who'd gotten kicked out of parochial school for bad behavior. Really bad actors, really, really bad actors. And so just even going to that school was an incredible collision, you know, of worlds. I was just, you know, a Jewish kid, you know? And I had this kid next to me in my homeroom in the 10th grade, Ronnie, I can still see him. And he had this pile of paper on his desk every morning in homeroom. And finally, I got up the courage after a couple months. I said, you know, Ronnie, what's with the slips of paper? Are you doing some math project or something, you know? He looked at me and he said, those are the numbers. And I said, what's the numbers? You know? Blockhead, you know? He was running a numbers racket in our high school. You know. So that's to answer your question, Michael, that's a collision. That's a collision. Yeah. Different realities. Yes.
Aaron, as a multi-genre writer, how do you choose what's going to come out as a poem, or does it choose you to write it as a poem?
Yeah, poems are pretty particular. That's what I'm steeped in. So I mean, it took me decades to be able to write, you know, something resembling decent prose. Poetry is pretty much my natural language, where my head goes. So it's not a decision thing. The prose stuff is those tend to be more like, what do they call, projects. You know, I wanted to write about race in Baltimore in 1962, 63, write about a woman before feminism, and that was way beyond a poem or two. So, yeah. Yes, Justin.
What do you see that it will happen with a poem? Because poems have been changing throughout time.
Right.
And where do you see it going? Because I do see more and more loss of it. It warns me that there are some generation, there are some people in my generation that are missing the point of a poem.
Right.
So where do you see it going?
I'm actually strangely optimistic, basically because it's been around for thousands of years, and you know, it's bigger than we are, basically. And it basically contains the human impulse to praise being, basically. I have to believe, as long as there are people here, that's just a basic human impulse. So, you know, that doesn't make me pessimistic. Any other questions? Lulled into contentment. Yes, Karen.
I loved the collection, which I read a couple months ago, first time. And one of the things that I noticed was that collision, I guess you could call it a collision, between the like personal world and then the more historical, kind of bigger, you know, references that are made. And I just was curious when I was reading it if you had how much research was involved in terms of if you go out and how that influences your process.
Yeah. I read a lot of history. That's just something I do as a reader. I mean, I'm the kind of guy who belonged to things like the History Book Club, accumulating hardbound books that I'll only read once, that my wife says, do we need all these in here? You know? So that's just who I've been forever, basically. Yeah. So, and still am. Still read a lot of history. It's not research. I'm really not capable of doing that, frankly. Index cards were too much for me, you know,
right,
so.
Right.
Yeah.
That's a great title for a poem.
I'll give that one to you.
Do you, as part of your process, do you read as a, and No, that wasn't the end of the question.
I
took a pause, and he's looking at me like, you've been here
I've been
for
reading
2 years.
Decades.
Oh, God. Let me rephrase this. You know, as a fiction writer, I am not the kind of person that is able to write. And so I kind of absorb things. And so I'm walking, or I'm seeing a movie, or I'm researching when I feel like I can write, then I write. But then there's this downtime. So I'm thinking, like, for poetry, I was a songwriter, but it's slightly different. And you're a very different poet than almost anybody I've ever heard or listened to. And so I'm curious, do you absorb? Like, for me, part of my process is not sitting down 5 hours a day and writing. And of course, I judge the shit out of myself for that. But that isn't working really well for me.
Don't.
So, exactly. So what I've come to realize is that part of me is observing. Like, I'm observing and absorbing. And I'm doing things that feed the writer in me and the project. So in terms of, let's say, a book of poetry, do you know it's going to be a book of poetry? Or do you write the poems and then you say, wow, these poems kind of make the subject matter?
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, I do know what you mean. And you write the poems. And for me, at least, that then becomes a book. I have done a couple books that were, one book, because of form, all the poems are 14 lines, okay? And then I did a chapbook based on a clueless president of the United States, and they were all about that figure, okay? But mostly it's what you're saying. You collect things and becomes a book, and since it's written by you, you hope it has some degree of coherence. Yes, Mark.
So, like the Port Authority poem, was that something that you had since the 1960s, or was that something that you just a memory, or was it listening to Sullivan Brothers?
Memory. I mean, before New York got cleaned up, it was a pretty raunchy place.
Yeah.
And even for, you know, blockhead kids getting off buses. And so, that's only a, you know, part of some memories from that era.
Yeah.
Surprised you
have so much. Just kidding. You were seeing the Allman Brothers, you know?
That's okay. Lawrence has no doubt seen a poem of mine that was reprinted in Harper's in the 1980s called Dropping Acid and Uncle Harry and Aunt Clara screwing everything. So, you're welcome.
Really?
Yeah, really.
Awesome.
Go look on that internet.
Sorry,
too.
My contemporary poets do you recommend
to you? Gazillions. Gazillions, yeah. I mean, really, they're certainly the two who, you know, are still with us, who, to my mind, are great poets, would be Richard Wilbur and W.S. Merwin. And you should read everything by them. They're great, great poets. And then there are a host of other wonderful poets. So. I have lists on my computer. Send me an email and I'll give you 100 to read.
I'm interested in the difference, if there is, between poems that are more personal or more social political. I have a hard time with inspiration that feels honest when it comes to the social political piece.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't like to do anything that doesn't feel
right.
Honest. And I'm wondering, have you ever, do you have a sense of what I mean when I say that?
I do.
How one taps into that versus the more personal?
Yeah, well, I think I do. I mean, a lot of so-called, you know, social political stuff turns out to be preaching to the choir, self-righteous posturing, etc., which is really tedious. I guess my antidote is a sense of humor, basically, you know. So you want to take these things on, but you want to take them on at some angle so that the less than obvious, shall I say, will emerge, perhaps.
Can you share one of those examples?
Can I share one of those examples?
Yeah, that one of those poems that you just talked about.
Yeah, well, in terms of, the thing is,
why I asked for that was because it really saddens me to hear you say that, you know, you only have a few guys on the farm working on the real business,
mm-hmm.
because poetry as a form
mm-hmm.
is the most celebrated literary form in China,
right.
and in Russia as well.
Yeah.
Now, if you go to Beijing and you see, you know, guys with long hair and cowboy boots and tight jeans
mm-hmm.
walking along like rock stars,
mm-hmm.
poets.
All right.
Yeah. And they are professional poets.
Yeah.
That the government pay them as salaries mm-hmm. and houses, you know. And they are very dangerous. They have to keep them paid because
right.
otherwise they write very dangerous stuff. Tips, and all the Chinese
your passport ready?
And all the Chinese revolutions have
yeah.
been started by people
yeah.
like you.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, we're safe here, aren't we, Doc?
A little too safe.
And you're right. I mean, again, I have a dear Russian friend.
Yeah.
I mean, there are boats, you know, boats, big boats, and they're named after poets, you know. It's going to be a long time before you stand on the prospect of Brooklyn Heights and see the SS Harp Crane, you know, come down the river, you know. But, you know, obviously, you know, we talked about this, Doc. I asked Doc, I think it was last winter, perhaps, let's drop the time here. Because I've read Chinese poetry in translation for decades and decades, and I said to Doc, what is the effect of classic Chinese poetry on your wonderful writing? And he essentially answered, it's everything to me. Would that be fair, Doc?
Yes.
Yeah, fair.
Yes, absolutely.
And that just tells you a great deal. Now, obviously, the history is so enormous and so rich. Whereas here, we're a new country, and basically just, you know, what do they say these days? We're a startup, basically.
Startup.
And so poetry is as much a startup as anything here. And I mean, it took 100 years, really, before they could sort of push away the shadow of Britain here, you know, from the revolution. So it's very much a work in progress.
So that's the reason.
Yeah.
Because it's young. It's young.
Yeah, young. Absolutely.
As a professional.
Absolutely.
We have some of it in our musicians. I think that Dylan and Paul Simon and some of those people are practically.
It's not like we don't produce poetry, but we don't have that tradition
yeah.
that Daw is
yeah.
talking about. Yeah. That's yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, one more question and then.
Like Akhmatova and like I really get into Russian literature, so Akhmatova
mm-hmm.
and of course Pushkin, like the
right.
her.
Yeah.
That really got me into reading.
Yeah.
But it's in translation. Well, how do you feel about reading in translation? Because you're basically trusting whoever the translator,
yeah.
and then you have to know who the translator is to make sure that this is as close to
yeah.
what the original intent is.
Yeah.
I mean, you have to be influenced by these things and. One of the things that we don't have, I'm a big fan of Mikhail Bulgakov.
Mm-hmm.
We aren't censored anymore, and he was censored
That's
to
right.
the point where he just made the most beautiful imaginary world.
Yeah.
I mean, The Master
Margarita. Margarita's a great book.
I love that book so much.
Yeah.
But maybe that is one of the things, maybe we're, I mean, not that we should be under a regime that, no, I'm not advocating that, but it's, but do you understand what I mean? Like when you're forced to come up with a different way to say something,
right?
You know, which is something I would love to do, but it's not even necessary anymore. I mean,
right.
how do you feel about that?
Well, what I feel essentially is in those societies, because I have taken a lot from Polish poets, post-World War II Polish poets, for instance, and often the societies, basically, given that things are so tight, so restricted, human action often has enormous consequences, okay? In terms of you agree or you don't agree, that has very big consequences for each person, okay? So whether it's in fiction, in Kundera's novel, or in poetry. I guess my answer here, basically, is that for me, and this has to do also with the era I grew up in, okay? I mean, in the year 1969, okay, my mother died, okay? I met the woman who became my wife. I went off to graduate school. I was drafted, and I was declared psychologically unfit by the U.S. Army. They knew what they were talking about. So those are five things in that period of time.
Right.
Okay. So that's a lot of consequentiality
right.
in my life. So so that just sort of, I don't know how to say it, just that's how I feel and see life. Okay.
Yeah.
But obviously a lot of people in this society don't, basically, because it's going another way. It's all about freedom, choice, possibility, happiness. It's not about that. Different outlook.
Right.
Yeah. Thank you all so much.